Now let's look at control charts for attributes. One of the most popular and useful one is called P-chart. Most of the time, P-chart is used to monitor the proportion of defective items in a sample. In P-chart, center line is the average value of P across all samples, which is called P-bar. Essentially, P-bar is nothing but the average sample proportion defectives. The upper and lower control limit of P-chart are given by these two formulas. Z is the usual standard normal variable, Z-score. Sp is the standard deviation of proportion defective. The formula for Sp is this, and this is coming from the standard deviation of a Bernoulli distribution. Now let's look at an example how P-chart works. We have the following information. 5 samples of data tracking incorrect procedures in a hospital, and the sample size is 10, that is to say 10 procedures are inspected in each sample. So total, we inspected 50 procedures, out of which 5 of them are incorrect. Next, we are gonna compute upper and lower control limit in our Excel file. Okay, first the thing we're going to do here is to find P-bar. P-bar is nothing but the average defects. It's equal to total number of defects divided by total number inspected. In this case, it's 10%. Standard deviation of P-bar is given by SQRT P times 1 minus P bar divided by sample size. In this case, it's 10. So SP is about 9.5%. This score depends on the level of confidence we want to have. The most useful one is 99.73% confidence interval. The corresponding z value will be 3. Here, that's what we're going to do. So we're going to look for 3 sigma upper and lower control limit, or 99.73% upper and lower control limit. And what if we want to say 95% confidence level? Then z-score will be equal to 1.96. It comes from the standard normal distribution. Okay, let's see how it works. Upper control limit is equal to P bar plus Z times SP. Lower control limit will be equal to P bar minus 3 times SP. Now we have a problem over here. Lower control limit is a negative number, which doesn't make much sense because we're dealing with the defective ratio. So here's what we're going to do. We're going to use the maximum number between 0 and the number we calculated earlier. Whenever the lower control limit is a negative number, we make it 0. So 0% defective ratio. In the end, we get lower control limit 0%, upper control limit 38.46%. That means we're 99.73% confident that the actual defective ratio will be between 0 and 38.46%. Now let's talk about process capability. By using the control charts like X-bar chart, R-chart, and P-chart, we can identify whether the process is in control or not. If a process is in control, the trouble is the process can be consistently bad, so we need to do something about it. A very useful concept over here is called process capability. And there are different index of process capability. One is Cp. The one I would like to discuss over here is Cpk. that is a more useful and popular one. The formula for calculating Cpk is here. Cpk is the minimum number between two values. One is the upper specification limit minus the sample mean divided by 3 sigma. The other value is x bar minus lower specification limit divided by 3 sigma. And x bar is nothing but the sample mean or process mean. Sigma is the standard deviation. Now let's take a look at the meaning of Cpk, process capability. If Cpk is a negative number, it means that the sample mean falls outside the specified range. If Cpk is zero exactly, it means the sample mean is right on the edge of the specification range. If Cpk is between 0 and 1, it means the sample mean is within the specification range, but there's one tail which is outside the specification range. And if Cpk is equal to 1, that means our process is within the specification range. And if Cpk is greater than 1, our process is well within the specification range. Generally speaking, the value of Cpk, the larger the better. The threshold value would be 1. Generally speaking, if Cpk is 1 or better, we say our process meets the specification. If it's less than 1, we are saying the process does not meet the specification. Now let's turn to an example and see how it works. Let's follow our previous semiconductor example. Suppose that the upper specification limit and lower specification limit for the chip diameter are 26 millimeters and 24 millimeters respectively. And we would like to calculate the process capability Cpk and determine whether the process meets the specification or not. Let's go back to our Excel spreadsheet. We did the X bar and R chart earlier, and right now we know that upper specification limit 26, lower specification limit 24, and let's see how we can calculate the Cpk. It's going to be equal to the minimum value between two numbers. One is upper specification limit minus grand mean divided by 3 sigma. Sigma is our standard error over here. The other is grand mean minus lower specification limit divided by 3 sigma, or 3 times SE. And the Cpk value turns out to be 0.38, which is apparently less than 1. So our conclusion is no, the process does not meet the specification.